and gentlemen. My name is James Woodward and I'm the principal of Sarum College, and I want to welcome you to the 10th annual Niblett lecture. I'll do this as briefly as I can, but I need to do three things, I think. First of all, I think it's right that we should remember in whose honour this lecture is being given, and to say something about that. Secondly, of course, to introduce our lecturer, and then to explain a little bit about the format. The lecture is held annually in honour of Professor Roy Niblett, who was a fellow of Sarum College and died in 2005. Professor Niblett was a modest man, but left an extraordinary legacy as a teacher. At the age of 93, and for those of you who are feeling your age today, this is for you, he was a testament to the fact that lifelong learning and age are no barrier to learning and doing new things. At 93, he founded the Seven Forum, a theological society which now has and is going on today, 150 members of all denominations and non. Niblett was a lifelong synthesist, and he was always more concerned to reconcile divergent views rather than distinguish between similar ones. He had a passion to see where growth was enabled or facilitated as people came together and the knife hit the steel, and in that difference, learning and wisdom were sharpened up and deepened. In someone commending Roy's legacy, his obituary offers this insight, and I think it's worth reminding you, even those of you who've heard this before. Roy was at his best in his beloved networks, where his genial probing and prodding of others more than compensated for a penchant high-level abstractions. A person of deep conviction, his work was distinguished by rigour, reason, and a willingness to listen and exchange, which he regarded not as a potential hazard to faith, but as an essential expression of faith. Niblett's presence amongst the Sarum Fellows was a powerful reminder to the college that at the heart of Sarum's purpose is the promotion of dialogue on the profound religious, social, and moral issues of our time. We're delighted that Ross Niblett, Roy's daughter, and Roland and Jill Niblett, his son and daughter-in-law, are with us this afternoon. And I want to say to them what a significant difference Roy's legacy has made to the learning life of this college. Now to our lecturer, Francis Young. Francis is one of the most engaging, creative and skilled theologians of her generation. She taught theology in the University of Birmingham from 1971. From 1986 to 2005, she held the Edward Cadbury Chair, serving as head of department, head of school, dean of the faculty, and pro vice chancellor. She was awarded the OBE for services to theology in 1998 and elected a Fellow of the British Academy in 2004. Now Emeritus Professor of Theology, She is still engaged in significant and considerable research and writing. New Testament studies and early Christian studies are her main field of interest. Frances was ordained a Methodist minister in 1984, and above all, and this is where my own particular memory of her and her work through our shared connection with the University of Birmingham most immediately and distinctively comes in, when I think of Frances Young, more than anything else, I think of a person who bridges academia and the life of the churches. She has been persistent and restless and indefatigable in continuing to engage theologically and use theology in and through a range of activities with the churches, particularly in the ecumenical world. She shares, I know, Sharon's passion in the nurture of theological seriousness for our human flourishing. Finally, I'd say two things about her writing. In 1985, Frances published the most remarkable book by Epworth Press called Face to Face. It is a moving account of Frances and Bob's son's life, Arthur, and their embrace of his profound learning disabilities. I think that what I remember from that book and its narrative is that Frances and Bob would say that through their son and his condition, they have been given privileged access to some of the deepest truths of Christianity. And if you haven't read and reflected on that book, I'm going to say utterly non-directively, your life is all the poorer for not reading it. I can offer no better incitement to purchasing the book at the end of the lecture than that. Incitement or encouragement, I don't know, choose your words carefully. Well, finally, in 2011, Frances delivered the Bampton Lectures in Oxford, in which she tried to bring all of the different aspects of her life as scholar, minister, and mother into a coherent theological understanding of creation, human existence, Christ, salvation, the Spirit, the Church, Mary, and the Trinity. The resulting book, God's Presence, a recapitulation of early Christianity, was published by Cambridge University in 2013. Frances is accompanied by her husband, Bob, and they live in one of the country's finest cities. I mean, of course, Birmingham. And thankfully, they have both returned safely from a cycle ride today, where this morning, happily, rain gave way to sunshine for that cycle ride to take place, and as they came back, has decided to return with them. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our 10th Niblett Lecture, Professor Frances Young. Her title is Reading Scripture Today.
And that introduction. I should say that Face to Face is now replaced by Arthur's Call, which is on the table. During my lifetime as a scholar, there's been something of a revolution in thinking about how to read Scripture. And what I propose to do in this lecture is first to outline and assess the method which was universally accepted in the mid-20th century when I began, and is still widely deployed in biblical scholarship. And then I will describe some aspects of the postmodern reaction against the so-called historical critical method. On other occasions, I have then followed this by talking about traditional methods, because one of my main research areas has been ways in which the early Christians of the first three or four centuries interpreted scripture. But today, instead of doing that, I'm going to go on a more recent journey I've been taking of looking at the Epistle to the Hebrews, because of course that is interpreting its scriptures, what we call the Old Testament, and trying to discern the sorts of ways in which the early Christians, the earliest Christians, the New Testament Christians were engaging with the scriptures which they inherited from the Jews. And then I will hope to offer you a model for reading scripture today in the light of these various explorations. I should say that on the way here, we stopped to pick up this artwork from an artist in Bath. And it's there for you to contemplate when you've given up trying to follow the lecture. And I will add an appendix in which I say something about its significance. And to help those of you who might be wanting to think what it might be all about, it's called Bethany Visitation, and it relates to the cover of God's Presence. But we'll come back to that at the end. So, first, the historical critical method. A number of things contributed to the rise of what we call the historical critical method. In the 15th century, the Renaissance and the work of scholars like Erasmus reminded people that the word of Scripture did not come in the Latin universally used in the Western Church in those days, but rather Greek was the language of the New Testament. And what we Christians call the Old Testament was originally in Hebrew. Now, around the same sort of time, printing began to supersede manuscripts. And questions about the differences between the handwritten witnesses became significant, because people were attempting to find out what lay behind these differences so as to provide printed editions of the pristine, uncontaminated original, if there were such a thing. So one big factor in the rise of the historical critical method was the drive to get back to the original, to pare away all the mistakes and the misinterpretations and the mistranslations that had accumulated over the centuries. Now let's pause there for a minute, because getting back to the original must be important. Think for a minute about meaning in everyday life. We all know we can't make things mean what we like. We argue about meaning every day, sometimes because we've misheard, sometimes because we haven't grasped the point the other person was trying to make. Occasionally, someone will say, well, I said so-and-so, but what I really meant was, and give you something else. So language carries meaning, whether we like it or not. We can't arbitrarily attribute meanings to words or sentences which don't fit them. To understand something requires establishing exactly what was said in the original language, and that involves acquiring the expertise to do it. Going back to the original. Now, a second factor was the rise of what has been called the romantic view of what happens when we read a text. In the 19th century, it was famously described as thinking the author's thoughts after him. Back in those days, it was usually a hymn as well. So primacy was given to authorial intention. The meaning lay in what the author had in mind when he wrote it. And this applied not just to the scriptures, but to classical texts and all kinds of other texts, even modern texts. The meaning lay in what the author meant when they wrote it. So in reading any text from the ancient world, the first thing was to grapple with the question, what was in the author's mind? This meant establishing who the author was, the time or occasion of the writing, how it fitted into the author's situation and purpose, so as to discern that original meaning. So dating, biographical details, events, relationships, all of these would provide clues to that authorial intention. And those are exactly the sorts of things that were discussed in all those introductions to the New Testament and everything that some people may have come across. Reconstruction of the original situation was fundamental to understanding. Now, pause there a minute. This too has to be important. In our everyday arguments about meaning, we sometimes find a person saying, "You misunderstand. I was referring to so-and-so, not so-and-so." Okay? You certainly do understand better if we know something of the circumstances. Paul provides us with the most obvious biblical example. He was writing letters to his congregations about all kinds of problems in the churches, and if we can reconstruct what was going on, we shall get his point much better. So now we come to the third key point. This was the rise of historical consciousness. That is, the sense that back then was not the same as now. Another famous quotation is, "The past is another country." People grow up within a culture which shapes their whole way of thinking, and people think differently in different cultures. And that applies not just across the globe, in different areas where people speak different languages, but across time, in different periods. So uncovering that other world where the author lived, becoming acquainted with the author's context, cultural assumptions, influences, sources, all of that could clearly illuminate what the author might have meant. And all that became crucial, and everybody began studying all kinds of parallel literature to see how words were used in different contexts and cultural discussions and all the rest of it. And of course, that remains so. For there is a lot more to translation than simply substituting the words of a different language. In fact, you can have great fun just translating words literally from one language to another and then turning out to mean something utterly different. There are all kinds of resonances and assumptions that are carried for people whose culture it is. And so, to understand the Bible, you need to enter the biblical world with an informed imagination. Here, the developing science of archaeology had a huge contribution to make, because this enabled setting the Hebrew Bible in the wider culture of the ancient Near East, as it was rediscovered through the unearthing and decipherment of things like Egyptian hieroglyphs and cuneiform from the Assyrian and Babylonian area. The sense of the otherness of the past also meant asking whether the religious and theological ideas were really the same as ours. You can put one word in place of another in a different language, but does it carry the same sense? What does it mean to ask about shifts in meaning between one culture and another when it comes to their religious and theological ideas. Now, of course, that perception encouraged attempts to make implausible narratives from the past fit modern understanding. For example, scientific developments challenged the possibility of many of the miracle stories in the Bible. So serious scholars looked for cultural explanations. What really happened was so-and-so. But back then, people didn't understand the world the way we do. So they imagined it happened in a way that we can't any longer believe it did. The past is a foreign country. Now, you can immediately see how those three factors would drive the enterprise that was called the quest for the historical Jesus. The Jesus of history had to be distinguished from the Christ of faith so that we could uncover what really happened. You can also see how the historico-critical method could enable theologians to meet the scientific challenges to the Bible's accounts of creation. These stories, of course, came from a pre-scientific culture, and they reflect the understanding which we find elsewhere in the ancient Near East, though interestingly with some significant differences, which may give us a clue as to what's really important in the Bible. But you see, those two areas, the historical Jesus and creation, they're just two of the consequences of the historico-critical method, which have caused controversy and still do in the deep divisions between so-called liberals and fundamentalists. The important thing to notice is that both liberals and fundamentalists were, and still are in many cases, stuck with the historico-critical method, the original historical meaning, or it's sometimes called the literal meaning, understood in those terms. That is the starting point. The particular kind of literal fundamentalism that has long been around in conservative Christianity is therefore the child of modernity. It is not traditional interpretation. It is as much concerned with the factuality of the events behind the text as our so-called liberal scholars. All alike agree that the original meaning is the only valid meaning. It is, we might say, an entirely archaeological approach. And so you get the rise of so-called hermeneutics, which is all about the theory of how you interpret texts from one culture in the context of other cultures and all this kind of stuff. So, the biblical scholarship of the 19th and 20th centuries was dominated by these assumptions. To understand the Bible properly, you need to be expert in the languages and cultures of all the different periods from which the biblical books come. And since they come from a vast period of, you know, hundreds of years, that means that experts become narrow specialists in particular bits of the Bible, and ordinary readers are dependent on the specialists, dependent on the experts if they're going to understand the scriptures. Understanding means, it was thought, grasping what the text meant originally. And it wasn't the job of experts to tell us what it might mean for us now. Nevertheless, before we go on, I must underline that the method has had enormously important fruits. It has meant, for example, that Jews and Christians could join together in a common enterprise as they try to understand the same texts in their historical context. And since Vatican II, Roman Catholic scholars have been able to join in the same project on the same terms. It's been ecumenically important that there's been a common understanding of what the appropriate methods of interpretation are. It also enables study of the Bible to be conducted in the public domain. You're trying to find objectively what the original meaning was. So its meaning can be debated in the academic world of specialists without any reference to prior commitment or belief. But despite all those benefits, there has been a huge reaction, and that is what we now must turn to. So my second thing, which I promised to do, was to talk about postmodern approaches. One of the first big challenges concerned the supposed objectivity of the method. It had long been evident that despite shared methods, historians came up with different reconstructions. Of course, because you're always trying to balance evidence against evidence, and you have this insight, and so-and-so has that insight. And so you get different theories about meaning, even amongst the experts. Whatever the assured results of research, they were constantly met with alternative proposals. I used to tell students the questions are more important than the answers. It became evident that no investigator could ever be divested of all presuppositions, and readers always bring implicit assumptions to their reading of the evidence. People also began to question the value of an exclusively archaeological approach to meaning, because of course this distances the reader from the text. Why read any text from the past if it's incapable of impacting on present readers? The same applies, of course, to the then prevailing way in which historical research determined the meaning of Shakespeare. Why bother to go and watch a Shakespeare play at Stratford if it means nothing to us now, if it's just historical? Meanwhile, over there in Europe, which, you know, lately we seem to be a bit worried about, over there in Europe, they began to develop critical theory, particularly in the intellectual trends in France. And critical theory began to change the whole approach to literary texts. This affected biblical interpretation as well. David Lodge, of course, was one of my colleagues in Berlin. Do you know some of David Lodge's novels, I expect? Well, he was also into critical theory, I can tell you. So we started with structuralism, and that shifted the focus away from authorial intention. The French thinker Roland Barthes wrote a famous essay entitled The Death of the Author. Attention was given instead to analysis of the text itself, to the structure of whatever literary work you were studying, to the way in which the language structured the meaning that was actually there, irrespective of what the author had in mind. And very often, texts carry a surplus of meaning that the author never intended. A famous, well, poet and critic, T.S. Eliot, used to refuse to say what his poetry meant. It's whatever people could see in it. There was more meaning there than he had in mind when he wrote it. Now that is particularly, of course, important in poetry because it's always in symbols and metaphors and pictures, and it's always pointing beyond itself. But that may be true of any text, and an awful lot of the Bible is poetry, you might note. So there could be a surplus of meaning beyond what the author intended, But structuralism, the focus on the text itself, soon gave way to interest in the reader. For when you stop to think about it, something like this text I've got in front of me, from which I'm lecturing, it's just a piece of white paper with black marks on it, isn't it? Until I start interpreting it and reading it out to you, or otherwise communicating what's going on this piece of paper. So the reader is absolutely essential to the whole operation. The ancient text has to be replayed in the mind of the reader, otherwise it's just a piece of paper with black marks on it. So the reader's contribution began to be really significant, and there's a huge PhD industry in the States in the late 20th century, reading things in terms of the reader, and discovering that, the best example is the Sherlock Holmes story. You will read it differently the second time from the first time. Because the first time you're reading it blind, aren't you? You're trying to piece the clues together. But when you read it for the umpteenth time, like my husband, who's a Sherlock Holmes fan, you're actually remembering from previous readings, and you actually see other things in the text that you're reading. So the reader's contribution becomes really important. And then people started noticing there were such things as reading communities. And if you like, they become critical fashions and everybody goes along the same line. Or you have church communities who read the scriptures in a particular way. There's a social setting for reading, which you have to take account of. And then people start noticing that texts acquire authority within communities and can even create or consolidate social worlds. For example, the Bible reinforced social orders which included slavery and patriarchy. And of course, this is where the whole business of feminist theology began to come into the mainstream. Because if you say the Bible is consolidating patriarchal societies, then you raise fundamental questions about how it should be read in a different kind of social order. And so people began to talk about the future of the text, its potential to generate meaning rather than just, as it were, passively containing meaning. And this became important for interpreting. We're not anymore just looking at the past of the text, its background, we're looking at its potential future. Now, as a result of these various trends in postmodernism, the question how text should be read is more open than it's been for 150 years or more. It was generally assumed that arguments, especially between liberals and conservatives, were about the facts behind the text. Questions about miracles. Now, arguments are about the future in front of text. Issues such as the position of women or the acceptance of persons who are gay, we all know these are the controversial issues now, aren't they? This greater openness creates a different kind of uncertainty. And so my next question is, might it help us to consider an example of how a particular New Testament text interpreted its own scriptures? And we're going to take the Epistle to the Hebrews as an example and see what turns up. One scholar has suggested that during the so-called modern period, I quote, academic interest in Hebrews lagged behind research into the Jesus of history, the Gospels and Paul, because of, I quote, the lack of consensus on most historical questions. The Epistle to the Hebrews remains a riddle, because everything about its historical origin, I'm quoting the scholar again, is in question, not least its authorship, its anonymity, the indefiniteness of its historical location before or after 70 CE in Rome or Palestine or somewhere else, its uncertainty about its audience, Jews or Gentiles or both. All of these uncertainties have meant that it has not served well as a marker of any particular stratum of Christianity. Moreover, its quite distinctive strand of theology has heightened the hermeneutical problems. That is, how on earth you make sense of it. So suppose we approach Hebrews with a different set of questions, acknowledging that we haven't a clue who wrote it, nor what day, nor when it happened. We know it comes from early Christianity, and very early Christianity, and eventually people agreed it should be in the scriptures, and they started saying, well, it must be by Paul, because they have nobody else to fall back on. Modern scholars have come up with all kinds of bright ideas, of course, but you can't prove anything. So suppose we approach Hebrews with a completely different set of questions. Might we then be able to unlock the epistle's meaning and rediscover, perhaps for ourselves, more traditional models of how to read scripture? For Hebrews is itself a text which engages in the dynamics of interpretation. It's all about interpreting the books the author and readers knew as scripture. Now, I've got a list, I think it's probably in front of you, of the various debts that my analysis is going to owe to post-modern criticism. There's no attempt to apply any particular method, but I just want to highlight trends which you may identify as I go into analysing and interpreting Hebrews. The first is a focus on the text itself. Greater interest in the structure and rhetoric of its argument rather than the author's original situation or sources. A shift from the past of the text, worrying about its background, original tension, and so on, rather to its present impact and future influence, and that applies to the text Hebrews is reading and our own reading of Hebrews. A willingness to respond to the text's otherness, to respect difference, while also being challenged by it. An interest in hearing what the implied reader was meant to hear. So if you read a text carefully, you can begin to see what the author assumes the implied reader will know, or how the implied reader might respond, and then how actual readers might respond, given that actual readers now are not the implied readers. A readiness to explore the surplus of meaning carried by language, to take figures of speech as potentially generative of multiple senses, and so take the text both in part and whole as possibly carrying new connotations. And a recognition that interpreters belong to reading communities and that these communities shape interpretative traditions which themselves arise from the community's presuppositions and prior expectations, as well as the kind of questions which are asked of the text by the community. My aim, then, is to reassess Hebrews' own interpretive procedures as its argument draws on and interprets the then-known scriptures so as to uncover their sense in relation to Jesus and conversely, draws upon and interprets the person, life, and death of Jesus by relating him to Scripture. Perceptions of neither, I suggest, are left unchanged by this process, nor could an engaged reader escape the text's challenges unaffected. So in Hebrews 3, verse 7 and elsewhere, we read, "Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts." Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Now, the implied reader, or rather hearer, because the text may have originally been preached as a homily, and even if not as a letter, it would have been read aloud to the community. So it's the implied hearer. The person addressed is expected to hear this plea as a word for today. Today, now, directly and immediately. And yet, those words are actually words from Scripture. They're explicitly stated to come from David, and so from the Psalms. Now, the significance of that direct address should not be underestimated. Of course, scholars have analysed use of the Old Testament in the Epistle to the Hebrews, but that is to objectify something which I suggest belongs in a different category. For in Hebrews 4:12 we read, "The word of God is living and active, sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart, and before him no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render account." One of the most striking things I found reading some of the earliest things in Christian literature which didn't get into the New Testament is their universal belief that God sees right into your heart and knows what you're thinking. And that is expressed here in terms of the Word of God piercing right through. So today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. This direct today comes as both the climax and the entry point of an argument designed to demonstrate this immediacy. And it does it by drawing past narrative into the present, inviting the hearers to reimagine themselves in the story. To reimagine themselves in the story. So, we have in 3:7 following a quotation from the final verses of Psalm 95. To harden your hearts is to act as in the rebellion, as on the days of testing in the wilderness. In other words, the Exodus narrative is a reminder of present potential to repeat the ancestors' mistake of putting God to the test, risking the same angry response. I quote, "Therefore I was angry with that generation, and I said, they always go astray in their hearts, and they have not known my ways. As in my anger I swore, they will not enter my rest." Now that is still Hebrews quoting Scripture. And it's direct to the hearers or readers of the epistle. Today means now. There is here and now a possibility of turning away from the living God. But it also means that there's a possibility of entering my rest. The rest remains. The rebellious people who left Egypt under the leadership of Moses were the ones who were disobedient and refused entry to his rest. So to others, hearing the word today, the rest is still open. God's Sabbath is available to believers. It was ordained at the foundation of the world, but the very denial of it to Joshua shows it still remains for God's people. The promised land still lies ahead. So the hearer must be sure not to repeat what happened back then. So in this way, the central motif of the scriptures is transmuted into present exhortation. And yet, it's more than just exhortation. It's giving people vision and meaning. It's making sense of the hearer's present and future. Oh yes, you read the commentaries, and the scholars all say it's typology. And that classifies it. But it doesn't begin to capture what it means genuinely to live within Scripture in this way. It tames that two-edged sword, which exposes where the hearers stand, while offering incentive to persevere in the way of Christ. And what becomes clear in the next verses is that Jesus has taken this new exodus before anyone else. He has passed through the heavens as pioneer of the way to that promised Sabbath rest. Earlier in chapter 2, we hear of him persisting through suffering, as made perfect so as to bring others to glory, as not ashamed to call others his brothers and sisters. He took the way before them so as to free them from the power of death. Indeed, he was tested by what he suffered, and so is able to help those tested on the way. So those who follow, the implied hearers, those who follow need to strive to enter the rest, to go on to perfection, hoping in Jesus, the forerunner, on our behalf. He has entered heaven itself, and so, I quote, we have confidence to enter the sanctuary, to go through the veil, through the curtain, into God's true house, by the new and living way that Jesus has opened up for us. Potential PowerPoint slides, you will see lots of references to Hebrews, and these are all references to the references, if you like, which I'm trotting through. So, to persevere in faith is to look to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. The Exodus motif, despite all the other things going on around it in Hebrews, lies at the very core of its argument. And the whole point is that the struggles of the journey and the promise of its pursuit are present reality, made both more real and more possible by Jesus the forerunner. So, in the rhetorical dynamic of this epistle, Jesus and Scripture present the implied hearer with the same immediate demand and inspiration. Both Jesus and Scripture constitute the Word of God, addressed directly to those addressed by the epistle. There's no hermeneutical gap to be bridged. There's no self-conscious interpretive method to be followed. It is direct address, and the implied hearers become incorporated into the long line of the faithful in generation after generation. And of course, when you get to Hebrews 11, you get a whole catalogue of these past models, culminating in Jesus at the beginning of chapter 12. And Scripture becomes contemporaneous, because these people are a cloud of witnesses to those who are struggling along on the journey. A journey which leads not to the terrors of Sinai, but to the city of God, the heavenly Jerusalem. And so here and now, response to the warnings is urged. What I want to emphasize is that there's a two-way dynamic here. There is a possibility of a renewed Exodus journey to the true heavenly Jerusalem opened up by Jesus. And to make that argument, the dynamic has to work both ways. On the one hand, Scripture and Jesus are set in a certain degree of opposition to show the relative ineffectiveness of what was originally set out in Scripture, and on the other hand, to draw out from Scripture the very models that demonstrate the identity of Jesus and the prize, the promised prize of salvation. The key text used to achieve this two-way dynamic is Jeremiah 31:31-34 about the new covenant. The whole passage is quoted in Hebrews 8, and the epistle comments, in speaking of the new covenant, he's made the first obsolete. But then the two-way dynamic is still implicit, because the model of the covenant made on the Exodus journey remains and yet is transformed. This new covenant effectively produces righteousness and perfection because it's written on hearts and minds, not tablets of stone. You have this oscillation between the scriptures and the new reality which is being interpreted through the scriptures. So we have this interaction between Old and New Covenant, running right through the argument of Hebrews. Jesus illuminates the true meaning of Scripture. Scripture identifies Jesus. And through that process, a reading community is created, which identifies itself as descended from Abraham, reads its scriptures as always pointing beyond themselves and forming this new religious community. One no longer dependent on sacrifice and priesthood for access to God, and yet still wedded to the memory of those God-ordained means of offering worship, because these are now revalidated as a way of reading the significance of the death of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. So I'm going to skip over some details about sacrifice and priesthood, because I can see the clock running on like fun. And I'll simply say that in the book on the table over there called Construing the Cross, there's a whole chapter which will throw some light on this. And I'm going to start and move on to asking whether we can learn to read Scripture from Hebrews and its interpreters. So let's begin where we began, remembering Hebrews' assumption about the immediacy of the scriptural text for the reader. Modernity may seem to have destroyed that innocence, for we are indeed aware that the past is another country. But has it? Instead of us exercising critical superiority over the text, might we allow the text to challenge our world? Could we imaginatively and empathetically enter into that other world of the text and come away with changed perspectives? Isn't that what readers regularly do with texts, especially novels? Namely, enter into worlds of human experience that they've not previously experienced. Well, the imagination does have to be retuned to read Hebrews by attention to our own presuppositions, as well as the text's otherness, all that stuff about sacrifice and all that, which we've skipped over, which isn't part of our world. But to return to the key metaphor at the heart of Hebrews' sense of immediacy is surely not beyond the bounds of possibility. To speak of life as a journey may be pretty banal, but that very banality could enable immediate empathy with the challenge that Hebrews offers. The reasons why perseverance in the Christian way remains tough now may be quite different from Hebrews' day, but it's hardly a problem for present believers to hear the urgency of Hebrews' appeal that today remains critical. following in the line of God's faithful over the generations, constitutes the fundamental core of this text, and indeed of the scriptures to which it appeals. To read so straightforwardly may at first sight seem a return to naivety, yet surely it happens constantly whenever scripture is read in the context of church worship. There, the possibility of reclaiming such immediacy is both normal and vital, for the Word of God is living and active, Hebrews tells us. It's also normal to recall examples of faithful living from scriptural narratives, just as Hebrews did. For present readers, a further motif in Hebrews might enhance this journey metaphor, namely the call to progress from immaturity to perfection, a move which, according to a long passage, Hebrews 5:11-6:6, involves probing greater depths of meaning so as to build on the basic foundations a more secure grasp of what the Christian way is all about, thus delivering better outcomes. Indeed, the dynamics of interpretation might suggest here a new and subtly different future for the text. Hebrews, if you read it, appears to put all the weight on obedience to God being the mark of perfection. But for us, slavish obedience is linked with immaturity. Maturity for us today is found in moral autonomy, isn't it? Maybe, however, Hebrews itself invites us, implicitly if not explicitly, to reflect that the whole point of the new covenant, written on the heart, not on tablets of stone, is not slavish obedience to rules out there. Rather, it involves willing response to God's grace, enabling a change of heart, the Greek word metanoia, which is often translated repentance, means changing your mind, a reorientation to respect the way of life embodied in Jesus and honour God's will to create a community of love, mutuality and collaboration. Mature persons accord dignity to one another by receiving from one another, not by exercising control. And if Jesus, and I quote from Hebrews, learnt obedience through what he suffered, we too learn and grow through a response to life's exigencies, shaped by the same unself-regarding commitment to love for others demanded by God's love. So, are we seeing deeper into Hebrews from our perspective, while also allowing it to challenge our own assumptions? We're called into the mutuality of covenant love, not individualistic moral autonomy, after all. Now, there are, of course, more difficult questions raised by the biblical themes most central to Hebrews: sacrifice, priesthood, and covenant. But I will just abbreviate all that and come on to say, every time people celebrate the Eucharist, present-day believers are reminded that they belong to that covenant community. Hebrews doesn't explicitly refer to Eucharistic practice, but the future of the epistle lay within the scriptural canon of churches which do liturgically celebrate this memorial of Christ's death, identifying the cup as the new covenant in his blood. As in Hebrews, so in the Eucharistic representation of his sacrificial death, Christ is present as both priest and victim, offering his own body and blood as the means of nurturing the communion or covenant bond between God and God's people. Yeah, there are other ways in which the liturgy moves beyond Hebrews, and yet there is a future for all that Hebrews is talking about in the ongoing celebration of the liturgy. So let me rapidly move on to a model of interpretation for today. In the light of Hebrews and against the post-war background, I want to suggest this model. It comes from ancient rhetorical theory, but parallels a good deal of contemporary communication theory. The object of rhetoric in the ancient world was to persuade people, to achieve persuasion or conviction. And the Greek word for that is pistis, which is usually, when it comes in the New Testament, is usually translated faith. So what is it that creates conviction, persuasion? On the one hand, there's the ethos of the author or speaker. That means the author's character and lifestyle has to be such as to inspire trust in their integrity and authority. In other words, the person should carry conviction. And then there is the logos, the argument, the narrative, the discourse of the speech or the text or whatever. It has to be convincing, has to be reasonable, has to be logical. And then there is the response of the audience, the pathos. If the readers or hearers are not swayed by the author and the argument, if there's no response, then the whole thing's ineffective and unconvincing. So conviction depended on that dynamic interplay of author, text, and reader. Orator, speech, and audience, and they interact. And as it happens, they are the three which modern and postmodern criticism have successively prioritized. But in the case of scripture, of course, we can see there's more than one dynamic triangle at work. The author may be identified as Paul, writing a letter to converts in Corinth. And he's trying to persuade them. And that's what we have in translation in our English Bibles. But if it's Paul writing a letter to his converts in Corinth, we are not the intended readers. So there is another dynamic at work, because we read it in the context of the whole canon of scripture, and we have a sense that somehow through this text the Holy Spirit is addressing believers and the text is scripture. So we have these dynamic triangles overlaying each other. It's a different set of reading genres, we might say. And none of them exist entirely pure, because we always carry one dynamic triangle over into the other as we read scripture. It's a text shaped by human history and circumstances, and we are too. Scripture is the divine word in human words. It's incarnational. It's meant to carry conviction. It's meant to change people's lives. In every generation and in different cultures, particularities, particular circumstances, particular people, they carry the eternal word of God. And we need to keep both dynamic triangles in play. The concern of the scholar, to be objective, the concern of the believer, subjectively, to hear the word of God. Both are valid and true to the nature of scripture. Now, this model necessitates the recognized involvement of the reader in the interpretation of scripture. Readers cannot simply make the text mean anything they like. They must respect the otherness of the text. On the other hand, we can discern a legitimate place for believers approaching the texts for spiritual transformation. For new insight is what believers seek from the texts. There's a danger of the text being a mirror, reflecting back their own prejudices, and it's a serious danger, but it isn't necessarily the outcome. Rather, the text stands over against the reader, challenging and calling the reader into a new future. But there's always this interaction between the reader, the author, and the text. And ideally, the transformation takes place within that interaction. I want to suggest that the theology that undergirds this is to see Scripture as in two natures. There is the human historical reality that these texts were composed by human beings in the language of the time and limited by the ideas and knowledge of the time, not to mention subject to the chances and changes of constant copying and translation down the centuries. But there is also the divine reality that the Word of God is alive and active. It cuts like any double-edged sword and slips through the place where the soul is divided from the spirit or joints from the marrow. It can judge the secret emotions and thoughts, for the Word of God was incarnate for our sake in the human Jesus, and the Word of God is inscribed for our sake in the fallible sometimes wording of this collection of ancient books. This is an essentially sacramental view of Scripture. Do I have a few minutes to talk about the art?
Yes.
After all that dull thing.
No, not at all.
Well, I said that the really key point is about reimagining oneself in the story. Reimagining oneself in the story and how this was happening within Hebrews. And to some extent, we did that as a community in reflecting on Hebrews and the liturgy, though I didn't say enough about sacrifice really to work that through. This Bethany visitation is a very personal version, because I think it's true for individuals too, that the key thing is reimagining ourselves in the story. On the cover of God's Presence, there is an icon drawn by someone called Sylvia Dimitrova. She's Bulgarian, she's married to an Englishman and lives in Bath. She was trained as an artist and trained as an icon painter, or technically we should say icon writer. And if any of you have ever read Jean Vanier, drawn into the mystery of Jesus through John's Gospel, he makes the audacious suggestion that Lazarus was a person with learning disabilities. If you look at the icon Sylvia drew for the cover of God's Presence, I challenged her to do an icon of Lazarus as a person with learning disabilities. And she's sufficiently free and gifted to be able to feel she can be creative with the icon tradition. So she struggled. How was she going to put Lazarus in a wheelchair? And she discovered the traditional icon of Elijah being carried to heaven in a chariot. So in the little icon, you've got a sort of representative of my Arthur as Lazarus, Lazarus as my Arthur. And there is Jesus reaching out to touch our lives, to touch Lazarus on the shoulder. And the tree of life is there, and in my Father's house are many mansions, the house is there. And if you ignore the back foot of Jesus, you can see an implicit sphere in the icon, which is the iconic symbol for God's perfection. And the sphere is, you know, if you look at the tree of life and the wheels of the chariot and Christ's back and so on, there's an implicit sphere, except for Christ's back foot. And this really bothered me for ages. until I realized that actually you can see it as Christ stepping down out of the perfection of God to touch our lives. So Sylvia and I had begun to reflect on the potential meaning of Lazarus being a person with learning disabilities. And I wrote a little poem which is in God's presence. And when we started talking, she also does things in her own style, which is influenced by icons, but is not properly iconic, if you see what I mean. And I wrote a little poem, and we talked about the possibility of this little poem becoming a subject for one of her own paintings. And into the painting, she's incorporated not only Jesus, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, but a gold strip which represents the presence of God. And up in the right-hand corner, there's deep blue, which represents infinity, absolute depth of infinity with the sprinkling of stars. And so there are various influences, and there's trees of life, of course, in the background as well. So there, the influence of the icon tradition and the wonderful colouring, of course, also comes from icon tradition. But this represents my little poem, which I'll now read to you. Jesus. He walked into my home. His eyes pierced my Martha soul. Martha's on the left, desperately trying to get Lazarus to take a drink from a cup which looks like a chalice, of course. One of the terrible struggles of our life has been getting Martha to drink. He walked into my home, his eyes pierced my Martha's soul. He sat and conversed by the fire. His words scorched my Mary heart. So there's the theologian with the quill pen and the scroll and the words of this little poem. He sat and conversed by the fire. His words scorched my Mary heart. He bent over the bed. His touch raised my Lazarus smile. The broken one he loved beyond us all. Reimagining ourselves in the story.
I'm going now, which is a tradition of the Niblett Lecture, to invite Bishop Peter Selby to give a response. For those of you who don't know Bishop Peter, he was, until relatively recent in the scope of God's time, the Bishop of Worcester, and also a theologian and writer. And I hope as a result of the conversation we had over lunch and beyond, getting ready to write another book too, which I think we came up with a very good title, but here we are. I'm going to ask Bishop Peter to give a response to Francis' lecture then, and give us some time for questions. Thank you.
Like you, I heard this for the first time now with no advance clue as to what would be said. One of the tasks I had in my former job, unfortunately, as a bishop, was to deal, of course, with complaints about clergy. And a particularly novel one arose in relation to a newly appointed Archdeacon, Joy Tetley, who had written her doctorate on the Epistle to the Hebrews. And I was phoned by a vicar in a state of considerable agitation and said, this new archdeacon you've appointed, Bishop, she's dotty about Hebrews. I asked what he would have preferred an archdeacon to be dotty about, and I can assure you there are many possibilities of things. But I owe to that particular colleague a fairly constant reference to this piece of text. And I knew that that was what was going to be a focus of Francis's lecture. And so I thought about it quite a lot. And what we've been presented with is of course a very remarkable, somewhat awesome, actually, combination of scholarship, philosophy, interpretative philosophy, and profound spiritual conviction. And that makes it quite difficult to follow after. But I don't have any doubt about one thing, and that is that while Francis was talking, all sorts of things were going on inside the minds and hearts of this particular audience. Because it was there in what Francis said, it was there, if I may say so, in her tone of voice, in the way in which she spoke, which had a definitely homiletic aspect to it. I think we were being challenged yet again. And it's very germane to what she has asked us to think about, that we should look at the dynamic of this particular lecture. Because when Francis speaks of the author of Hebrews is today, we hear her today, and we hear our today, and they're all different todays. And that's what I think was going on. And it's what goes on characteristically in hearing oratory and certainly in hearing preaching. And I was very conscious of, as Francis was speaking, of the fact that she speaks out of a tradition in which communities of interpretation, classes, are very much part of the way in which the Bible continued down the decades of Methodism to carry authority in that community, and I think it's illuminated the way in which it has carried authority in other Christian confessions as well. I mean, one of the reasons it was always clear that Hebrews had a particular claim on the attention of my colleague was its very considerable and frequent reference to priesthood. And it's not over analytic to say that for women seeking ordination in Anglicanism, this book has had a very considerable force, because the issue of priesthood was part of that community of peoples today, part of what they wanted to say, and have successfully, I think, to a great extent said, is that today, what the church today has to confront. But that leaves me with a question. And I think it's the question that I would want to to put to Frances and ask her maybe if she could be drawn a little further about. If we think about this constant overlaying of today's, the today of the psalmist, the today of the writer of Hebrews, the today of the tradition of interpretation, the today that Frances particularly brought to it, which is hers, and the todays of all the people gathered in this room. If we think about all of that, we have an incredibly rich range of pictures and understandings. But the problem is, of course, that these todays have to come into relationship with each other. And sometimes that relationship is conflictual. I used the word a few times, and I don't, unless I missed it, I don't think Frances did. I used the word authority. And the biggest issue around scripture at the moment that I perceive in the church is an issue around authority. It's one thing to say that a particular text arouses certain reactions in us, challenges us in certain ways, challenges us to read the way it's challenged other people in the past. It's one thing to say all of that. It's another thing to try and grapple with the question, what happens when these todays appear to conflict with each other? What happens when we are led to ask the question, how is this living and active word for now going to change what was always perceived to be the living and active word in our predecessors, our ancestors' todays? I think that I would be really fascinated if Frances would just say a little bit about the crisis of authority that we face, precisely because of our increased awareness of the things which Frances has so graphically described about the range of todays which are in play. And my last comment is really about the opening line of her poem, because of course one of the most I find most moving texts in Hebrews that certainly addresses my today and the today of our society is the text about remembering to show hospitality, because in showing hospitality some have entertained angels unawares. And it's a text which reverberates through debate about migration and refugees. It also reverberates through me when I find that I'm called to make some kind of personal response to such crises and see in them, he walked into my home. Well, that's a way in which I picked up what was said, but what I'd like to know is whether there are some ways of picking up what is said which have some kind of authority, some kind of, you use divine reality, which means that other todays or previous todays have to take second place.
Authority is something we accord to people. It's like persuasion or conviction. If we are convinced that we should actually acknowledge X, Y, or Z authority, it's like dignity. Dignity is something we are called to be. And I think one of the big problems is exactly our culture has so profoundly changed that we don't see authority inherent in things anymore. And it's the way in which we are enabled to accord authority to scripture, which, as you say, is contentious, and some people accord, one suspects, rather unrealistic ideas of authority to scripture, or to the Pope, or to bishops. For heaven's sake, we don't have them in Methodism. So I think that would be my starting point, that there is a problem about authority, and authorities relate to socio-cultural wholes. And all of these things at the level of human history, human society, human interaction, different societies, they're all constantly, I would say, in a state of flux. That is one thing that the ancient world didn't like at all. It wanted something eternal, changeless, and they hated this world of flux and change. I think we're conflicted in our culture about whether we want change or not. I mean, you try being at the top of a big organisation like a university and trying to get things to change. Whereas, you know, politicians are promising change all the time because they think they can promise change for the better. And we don't really know whether we want change or not, do we? Because in different circumstances, we react differently. So having put our situation in relation to authority and change and cultural change and all the rest of it into complete flux, what I want to say is that the danger is that people claim they have God's authority here in this interpretation of Scripture, or in this office in the ecclesiastical organisation. And as long as that kind of thing happens, then debate about different todays is going to become very painful and simply not resolvable. And I think one of the things that I've become more and more convinced about is that in the end, we all need much, much more humility than has generally been evidenced in the history of the church. And actually, we scholars need intellectual humility, because in the end, we cannot possibly know an awful lot. And actually, what goes on all the time is negotiation about our different today's. And what we need to do is to find those values which I was hinting at in terms of covenant love and respect and according dignity to one another and so on, ways in which to negotiate without getting into the awful mess that history shows us we get into time and time and time again. I think that's about all I can manage.